I'm here at Pier 51 on the west side of Manhattan to talk to you about the hand formula, the negligence calculus, and the case of United States versus Carroll Towing. One thing you gotta love about the negligence calculus is that it doesn't involve any calculus. It's just really simple algebra. So if you want to do some calculus, but you've never taken calculus, and that's part of the reason you went to law school, you can do the negligence calculus. It'll make you feel mathematically powerful. This is where it all went down. Now they've turned it into a park. It's actually quite nice. It's got a playground here. Inside the playground, they've got a little fake Hudson River. You put your little tugboats in there and play United States versus Carroll Towing. They've made the end of the pier look like the bow of a ship. Very cool. Let me take you around and tell you about the facts of the case, which are very complicated. All right, so over there across the way is Pier 52. Now at the end of that pier, there was a barge called the Anna C. It's tied up to Pier 52, and they've got five barges tied up behind it so that there's this line of barges coming out here, and the Anna C is tied to the pier. Then there's another line of barges coming out here from the next pier up. A tug, the Carroll, needed to get in here and get one of the barges out because they were moving one of the lines. Line is what sailors call rope. I want to sound like a sea captain from the 1800s. The Carroll tugboat, which is supposed to get that barge out, sent someone onto those barges, go up, check the lines that are holding the Anna C to the edge of Pier 52, make sure that they're fast. These facts are very complicated. I'm not sure that we even need to understand all these facts. The barge becomes adrift somehow. It starts floating down here, and right alongside Pier 51 is a tanker. The Anna C collides with the tanker. The propeller on the tanker punched a hole in the Anna C. That part's just like Titanic. Oh wow, I'm standing here. This is, yeah. I'm the king of the world! Okay, all right. Now, that's what happened. What could have prevented some of that bad stuff from happening is the bargee. This is the unknown AWOL bargee. Apparently, back in 1944, there was a job called bargee, where you hung out on a barge. Your job wasn't, I guess, to steer the barge anywhere, because it's a barge. It doesn't go anywhere. It just has to be towed around. Now, the bargee was supposed to be there during working hours. This bargee just took off the previous day and didn't come back. They went off into New York City. Maybe they were having fun, which is kind of bad because there's a war on, people are dying, and the bargee's not even doing their bargee job. And so at 2 p.m. that next day, when the Anna C collides with the tanker and starts taking on water, learned hand said the bargee could have noticed that the Anna C was taking on water and could have said something about that. Whoa, this barge is sinking. Your bargee had just one job to do. The tugboat, Carroll, and another tugboat named Grace, they had, according to the Second Circuit, siphon pumps, which would have enabled them to pump out the Anna C, save the cargo, prevent the sinking damages. Now, here's the crucial question. Is it negligent of the barge operator to not have the bargee on board? Is it a reasonable precaution to have the bargee on board? That's where we get to the hand formula, the negligence calculus. Learned hand says, maybe it's helpful to put this in algebraic terms. He's getting a little mathy. It's always exciting when a lawyer or a judge starts getting mathematical. where B is the burden, L is the injury, I think you picked L for loss, and P is the probability, then a precaution should be undertaken when the B is less than the P times the L. And he puts a mathematical expression there, the inequality, right on the page. It's right there in the reporter. If the burden of undertaking a precaution is less than the total risk, then you should do that. It's prudent. So what I'm gonna do to help the math challenged among us understand the mathematical inequality is I'm gonna break out the scales of justice. These are my scales of justice. All lawyers need scales of justice. You don't wanna wait until you get into court and then have the judge weigh the evidence or the equities. You want to do that ahead of time, before you go to court, so you're not surprised. That's part of client services. It's the responsible thing to do. If that's billable time, use your scales of justice. You should probably buy some scales of justice before you even graduate from law school. So I've got my scales of justice. Here we go. We can actually do the hand formula. We've got the burden. We've got the probability of the loss. In this case, having the barge on board, not that bad compared to the probability that something bad would happen with the Anisee, which in a busy harbor, learned hand said is, you know, that could happen. And then the loss, losing a bunch of flour, sinking of a barge. So the burden is less than the probability times the loss, the total risk, okay? So that means you should undertake the burden. We have negligence, you see right here. This wasn't supposed to happen. Move around, so, all right. But you can see that the burden is lighter than the total risk. Now, if things had been different, if it was like having a barge on board 24 hours a day, learned hand says, oh, the barge shouldn't be the barge's prison. That would be too much, apparently, according to learned hand. Okay, let's try it. Let's see which way it goes. Oh, having a barge on board all the time, that's too much. That's not negligence. That's an unreasonable precaution. That's too much. We're willing to take that risk. That's not negligence, not a breach of the duty of care. Look, it's a barge. It's got that notch there for the tugboat. So let's talk some details. The B, the burden. If you're gonna do this mathematically, it's gotta be in some kind of unit. So you could measure it in dollars, you could measure it in euros, you could measure it in units of goodness, then the L, if I can find my L, the L is the loss. It also has to be in some units, and it has to be in the same units as the B. If you're gonna compare the B to the L, then they have to be in the same units. If you've got human lives is the loss, and the burden is spending a couple thousand bucks, you've gotta then either put a monetary value on human life, or you've gotta put a fractional value of a human life on the couple thousand bucks. Can I tell you about the P? But I gotta find it. Ah, there it is. I can tell by feel, because I'm that good with letters. The P is the probability. The P is a number from 0 to 1. It can't be less than 0, and it can't be bigger than 1. You can't have a probability of 20. If it's a probability of 1, that means it's a certainty. It will definitely happen. And if it's a probability of 0, it means it won't happen. If you have a P of 0.5, that means it's a 50-50 chance either way. 0.5 equals 50%. That's probability. for the PL side, you got to take the probability and multiply it by the loss. That's why the P is a number between 0 and 1, because you're multiplying it by the loss. So if the loss is a human life and you're valuing the human life at $10 million and the probability of a person being killed by the activity that the precaution could have avoided, then you multiply 0.5 times 10 million and you get $5 million. If the precaution costs $4 million, you're negligent to not undertake the precaution. And if the precaution costs $6 million, then that's fine. You don't have to undertake the precaution. You can omit to take the precaution, let the person die, and you won't be negligent, at least according to the hand formula, according to the negligence calculus. That's how it works if you're valuing a human life at $10 million. There's not even a plaque here or anything. You'd think they'd put some kind of a plaque to the hand formula. I like that these are free. Don't require any quarters.